Never been in a position when you're always asking why, thinking that your tears will never dry. Every time that you glance at the sky, your mind's there, but you know you don't got the wings to fly. You feel the wind gently touching your skin, and the voices from within are yelling you shouldn't try. But you're not listening, on your face is a grin. You take the chance even if you shoot into the ground. The world says no, but you say yes. Don't let the negativity take over, do your best. The road you're paving causes feelings that are hard to express, but I promise you that at the end lies the success. Your chest is heavy, all the burdens you carry are slowly taking a toll on your mental inside. I want you to give me a promise and you to truly be honest that giving up is never going to be what you decide. I know that you've been running your whole life, walking through the darkness with practically no light, feeling depressed, under pressure, a low life, like there's no one to help you to get through all the cold nights. Look in the mirror, tell me, what do you see? A person climbing to the absolute peak. Don't need excuses, cause you are not weak. So chin up and be the very best you can be. Hero, you are a hero. Rain falling onto the windows, taking the whistles that appear as the wind blows. Remember as a kid for the ringtone, you had a great speech, tell me what did that kid know? He knew that failure is a part of success, he knew the lessons are what makes you progress. He knew your quest would put you under the stress, but he also knew the hunger that you truly possess. You've been a great one, still is what you're made of. You've been the same one ever since day one. Became a legend, haven't even finished phase one. Imagine what you'll be when you reach the main one. Unpredictable how one moment you're on the ground, and the next one you're flying high above the clouds. It's true, the higher you go, the longer you fall, but no matter what happens, you truly need to be proud. I know that you've been running your whole life, walking through the darkness with practically no light, feeling depressed, under pressure, a low life, like there's no one to help you to get through all the cold nights. Look in the mirror, tell me, what do you see? A person climbing to the absolute peak. Don't need excuses, cause you are not weak. So chin up and be the very best you can be. Hero, you are a hero.
To the strains of You Are a Hero, I welcome you to our August edition, our Emancipation edition of Reparations Now. In studio to take us through this week's discussion are Wozero Esther Gittins, the young lady with the multicolored gele this evening. Brother Eric, she is a representative of the Rastafarian community. Brother Eric Phillips, who is the deputy chair of the CARICOM Reparations Commission and chair of the Guyana Reparations Commission. Sitting next to him is our poet laureate, as Brother Eric usually says. But all I can say is that she connected up. And she's going to be doing a tremendous poem this evening, Imagine. And sitting next to her is Brother Royston Peters, who is the representative of the Essequibo Reparations Movement. This evening, we have got a very interesting discussion, and I would like us to pay very careful attention, because the words just said you're a hero. When the world says no, you say yes. and chin up. And that's what we have done. We have proved beyond a shadow of a doubt. And I want you to listen to this, that nothing is going to remove us from this planet. Nothing. No matter how dark it looks, we have shown that we can survive down in the bottom of the pit, and that we will continue to rise. And once again, we're going to show this world that we are heroes. And it ain't going to take long, you know. Just now, we're going to be running this world. Not Guyana. This world, we're going to be running this world just now. And so we're going to have this discussion about our condition here in Guyana and show that we are real heroes in Guyana. Then we look at some of our heritage, our cloth, and how it is applied in a Ghanaian wedding. And then we're going to have a discussion with Sister Esther, and then we're going to have that have a song, I Smile. So without much further ado, we go into our poet laureate's poem. And guess what it is? Imagine.
Imagine. This poem was inspired by John Lennon. Imagine, there is no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us, above us, only sky. Imagine all the people living for today. You may say, I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. Imagine, no possessions. I wonder if you can. No need for greed or hunger. A brotherhood of man. Imagine all the people sharing all the world. Imagine no slavery, no transatlantic, color, creed, or race. Imagine little black boys and girls in their tribal wear, not being profiled, gunned down, but left to be. Imagine all the people living for today. You may say, I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. So come on, imagine with me a continent not interrupted by greed, lust, anger, or jealousy, left alone, untouched by draconian hands. I am a dreamer, more like a visionary. So come on, envision this with me. A people seen for their worth, Ghanaian print like Kofi, Queen Candace, like me, or Makeda, Queen Sheba of Ethiopia, or Nefertiti. Yeah, Asantewa, Queen Nzinga, Cleopatra, or Hatshepsut. Imagine the Orishas of Nigeria flowing through our veins. Ocean, symbol of femininity, love, sensuality, water, fertility. Royalty supreme. Imagine melanated imagery plastered around the world. Hair that defies gravity. Skin that observes the sun. Beauty. Oh, what a sight to behold. Imagine a world rocking to the rhythm of the beat. Drums, chants, the elders shouting, Ashe! Love, light, colors, black tushy blue. Imagine more Olympians, you know, like Athlete Mu. Imagine more black running to launch an attack. Or maybe a comeback to one's purpose. Oh my God, imagine the tact. Use the open banks, not just to store some cash, but stacks. Watch me drive a Cadillacs. Okay, but here's a fact. Africans are back, and there's no turning back. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope one day you'll join us, and the world will live as one.
Brother Eric, you see, and Sister Wozero Esther, thing. You see why I said the young lady's connected up? The very same thing that I say, she say in her poem. And trust me, I never heard this poem before, I didn't know. So, Sister Crystal, I'm glad that you're with the Reparations Committee. You know, I'm tempted to ask, does anyone else have anything to say about Imagine?
Well, except to say spectacular, which is a mild term to use to describe it. I think it's a well thought out poem, and it is kind of reminiscent of who we are, and perhaps kind of positioning us at a point and projecting a way forward, and of course, remembering from whence we came. So it's a well tree structured poem, the history, the today, and then tomorrow. I feel an excellent job.
And if we look at it very carefully, if we look at the word imagine very carefully, you would see in that word imagine, image.
Oh, yeah.
And it's your image that gives you your imagination, and it's your imagination that determines just exactly what you're going to achieve.
Yeah.
Now, we were brought here under the most horrific conditions. We survived for 200 years under the most horrific conditions. But this poem tells us that irrespective of what transpired on the plantation and between then and now, there is a different image. There is an image inside of our minds. And that image rises above every single thing that we have faced. This evening, we're going to discuss a couple of the reasons why we appear to be at the bottom of the ladder, and that is how people see us. They see us at the bottom of the ladder, but trust me, we don't see ourselves down at the bottom of the ladder. The image that we have got inside of us is that we are heroes and we're here to conquer. Brother Eric, for 200 years working for no pay. Mm. Not 200 days, not 200 months or 200 weeks, 200 years, generations of Africans working for no pay. I mean, how come we survived that? Brother Eric.
Thanks, Brother Jonathan. As you said, people see us at the bottom of the ladder in Guyana, but they don't know the story.
All right.
They don't even know about the 200 years, which was a crime against humanity.
Yes.
The United Nations stated that. It was rape, it was plunder, it was murder, it was starvation, it was branding. It was break back work. 200 years of that while they extracted a wealth that made Europe wealthy. And then at emancipation, they further got paid. £20 million, which is about $30 billion today. And then another £27 billion during apprenticeship. So we worked for free and others got wealthy. And the others who came after us on the backs of our freedom, they were paid. Just to give you an idea, after indentureship, 2 acres of land were given to an individual, and for each child over 10 years, another 2 acres of land, a child under 10 years, half an acre of land, then another half an acre to build a home. So we were given nothing. We had to buy our villages. Others who came in indentureship and stayed were given lands that they turned into generational wealth. The village movement, which is what we saved up for communally to buy, which is our generational wealth. That wealth was attacked in 12 different ways, and in ways that still impact us today. Take, for example, we see Portuguese monopolies in Guyana, or large Portuguese companies. They were given licenses in our villages when we couldn't. And the British refused to buy directly from us. So the Portuguese became the middleman, bought from us, and resold to the British, who hated us so badly, they didn't want to buy from us, but they bought what we produced.
Can I make an interjection here? And this is indicative of the hero that is inside of us. Because if you took away our productive capacity, if you took away our income earning capacity, and if you gave to others those benefits which you were denying us, and we still have survived, brethren and sisterin and everybody who's listening, that's a sign of the hero. Continue, brother. Continue,
so just
brother.
Leading to the understanding of why one ethnic group owns 85% of capital and assets in Ghana. The Portuguese, which are less than 3,000, own another 12% of GDP. And the majority of us, Amerindians and Africans, who are about 60% of the population, including the mix, we own less than 7% of the population. But history has been, we've been misled. The East Indian colonization scheme that was discussed between 1919 to 1929 talked about bringing 750 families here and that they would get all these lands. They identified the lands. And today, even though that scheme was turned down by Gandhi, something amazing has happened. Take, for example, Mahaika. There were 32,000 acres identified in the East Indian Colonization Scheme that would have been given to these families. Do you know those lands, those 32,000 acres, are under rice production in Mahaika by Indians? So as much as the East Indian Colonization Scheme identified almost 300,000 acres of prime land, and it was turned back, mysteriously, those lands are owned by Indians, and we don't know how they got them. As we continue in our historical quest forward, Gaisuko, do you know at emancipation, at the day after emancipation, we had no homes, no jobs, no food, right? But Gaisuko, which was years later, East Indians were given 11,000 house lots and a fund to build housing, which again, as land is generational wealth and your home is your biggest possession, that generational wealth has continued to multiply. And you look at Gaisuko, the best educational system in the Caribbean in terms of scholarships. You look at Gaisuko, the best health system for people working in Gaisuko. So Gaisuko workers have been affirmed in such a way that they not only were given homes and a fund to create wealth, they were given the best education and the best health.
But I'd like to interject here, Zulfikar Mustafa. In a presentation at Enmore recently said, when they were announcing that the Enmore estate is going to be reopened, he said that the last government had shut down Enmore, but that the last government did not take into consideration that it was not just about the workers who were put out of pay, but it was the entire community which the Sugar estate supports.
He's right, because Gaisuko became a welfare state within the state, and that benefited primarily Indians. Then we go to others being affirmed. I spoke about the Portuguese in terms of getting money from Madeira and the British government, getting licenses in our villages. Look at what we would call the Amerindian Act of 2006. Amerindians were given 13.8% to Guyana. It's now up to 18%. Yet three of the nine tribes who got those lands weren't here before us. So 473,000 of our ancestors died. We built Guyana, we moved 100 million tons of earth, we cleared 15,000 square miles or 18% of Guyana, which is equivalent to 9 million acres. We died doing it, and then out of emancipation, we got nothing. But people out of indentureship got lands, and the Amerindians were made whole by given 13.8% again and now 18%.
I'd like to add this also too to the discussion, because it is a little known fact and I hear misrepresentations about it. Whilst we were being enslaved here in Guyana, both the British and the Dutch prohibited anyone from enslaving the Amerindians.
Yes.
So when they talk about the Amerindians being slaves and that kind of story, not in Guyana, it's a lie. They were a protected species. They
by
were
law.
Protected by the law.
As a matter of fact,
country.
They were partners. The yes. 1763 revolution, for example, part of the reason why it failed is that Amerindians were brought in, and they surrounded us in the north, so we couldn't move. And then they were used to hunt us down. Another example of that, rice. We were growing rice in 1763. Indians started growing rice in 1870. We were burnt out of rice. And when the Maroons escaped, and when Coffee and the guys escaped, they grew rice. The Amerindians were used to burn our rice out together with the Indians. So everything we tried to do, from the village movement to growing rice, there were steps taken to destroy it, whilst others were given the opportunity to create generational wealth. Black Bush Polder Scheme, the MMA, all these things are things that affirmed others. Businesses were brought by Chetty Jagan from India. Then you look at the more modern times. How did e-networks get that monopoly license? Look how valuable it is in a post-COVID environment, right? Look at radio licenses, TV licenses. Look at banking licenses.
And tell us about oil and gas.
Well, look at oil blocks. There were seven oil blocks given out to Guyanese. Four were given to Dookie when he was at CGX. One was given to him in his new company, which now has the Kanji block. So he got five. Then we had Ryan Pereira, who also got a license in the Kaichor block. And then we had Nabi. So of the seven blocks given out to Guyanese, six went to Indians and one went to the Portuguese. And we who died, 473,000 of our ancestors.
In that same sea.
Got nothing. And an oil block is about $100 billion. So when you look at those things, you see that all along, people are being informed. Gaisuko, 98% of the contracts went to one ethnic group. And that was about $6 billion a year. You look at all the things that are happening right now in local content. We're excluded. One of the things people don't know, because we keep complaining about the 25,000 for COVID, if you read the Guyana Times, you will see that the business community got 28 billion Guyana dollars in COVID relief. So throughout our history, others have been given the chance to succeed, the chance to be entrepreneurs. When everything we tried to do, we were burnt out of rice, our village movement, we had 12 things to destroy us. We didn't get any concessions. Jonathan, all of the wealthy people in Guyana, bar none, got wealthy because of state assets. Could be an oil concession or gold concession. Do you know that between, in the last 40 years, Guyana produced $7.4 billion US of gold? Who you think got most of that? Who has the forest concessions? Who has the sand concessions? So land is generational wealth, and whilst we are fighting to protect our lands in the villages, which don't have drainage and irrigation, others have been given lands and assets and all sorts of other things. And that's why we're at the bottom of the ladder. Our work during slavery showed that we're builders, we're agriculturalists, we're scientists, we built the seawall. But yet, we who've done all the work have gotten nothing. And here's an interesting fact which people don't want to hear. If our ancestors were given fair wages after emancipation, there would have been no need for indentureship. And at independence, Africans and Amerindians would own 100% of Guyana, including all the oil blocks and everything. So we have been penalized for doing all the work to build Guyana, whilst others who did not die, but it's World War I, World War II, or during enslavement, they've been given all the benefits of oil, land, gold, forestry, etc.
And I hope somebody listening to this presentation takes what you just said and put it in a nice little book.
But then again, look at the other devious things. The church undermined us. Indians rejected the church in teaching their young people because they were trying to change them from Hindus to Christians. Christianity, as much as it helped us, and it was sort of an oasis of hope during slavery, taught us to turn the other cheek. Taught us that if we were entrepreneurs, we wanted to be entrepreneurs, we wouldn't go to heaven because something too high of some camel, etc., etc. So we need to understand that what has happened to us has been public policy since 1621. We need to understand that everything we have done, there's been steps to destroy it. And so today we face the greatest threats to our culture, our economics, our health, because of
the extraction of
wealth from 1621 to now.
From our societies.
And now when we're supposed to get reparations, which would give us a platform for generational wealth, people are saying no. Yet the Amerindians were given that platform to the Amerindian Act of 2008, which is the only legal reparatory justice act in this part of the world. So there's a legal precedent. So there's no legal reason, and no moral reason, and no just reason why we shouldn't be given reparatory
justice. But let me ask a question, Brother Eric. What is to be done? The fact that we have survived the distortion of our image, the extraction of wealth from our community, the denial of the access to productive resources, which has not been the same for all of the others who are here.
And we're in the public sector where we're losing jobs.
We have still survived. Yeah, but what must we do?
We must be apolitical about this. We don't care who's in power. We need to get reparatory justice because it's a legal right to us. It's a human right to us, given the Amerindian Act of 2000. But we also need to plan our own African development. The political parties do national development. They don't do ethnic development. National development is trickle-down economics. And we're at the bottom of the ladder. So nothing trickling down to us. So we need to collectively form and develop a strategic plan for African Guyanese development and then give it to who is in power. Give it to the ABCs, give it to CARICOM, give it to the Black Lives Matter movement, give it to the Congressional Black Caucus, so that they can understand what we want to do and that it's fair and just and legal. We can't depend on political parties to develop a plan for us, neither the ruling party or the opposition. They've ever developed a development plan for us. We need to develop our own plan. So we need to do what the Amerindians are doing to some sense. They have a Toshos Council of 200 leaders. We need a leadership council of about 200 African Guyanese who are dedicated to understanding their history and their plight and developing a plan within the framework of the National Development Strategy.
Ronald Waddell used to make a statement. He used to say that there is a nation inside of Guyana, that the Indian people or that the Indians are a nation inside of this nation.
There are six nations in Guyana.
So that basically what you're saying, Brother Eric, is that we have got to create a different image of ourselves in this country.
For ourselves, by ourselves.
And we must imagine ourselves as a people with needs which only we can express. And I think it's only logical.
Jonathan,
you don't know where my shoe, you don't know where my foot hurting because of the size of my shoe.
Right.
I got to tell you where the shoe pinching me.
Jonathan, if you look at the last several years, there's been a total indifference to African Guyanese in this country. Whether you call it racism or not. Total indifference. So it doesn't matter what happens to us. No one cares. No other race in Guyana cares. The U.S. don't care. The British don't care. The Canadians don't care. They don't care. So we have to care, and we have to recognize that nobody's going to develop a plan for you. You got to develop your own plan. You understand your needs, you understand your history, you understand your strengths, your weaknesses, you understand the opportunities. And plan, and then give it to them. Because no one of them, well, first of all, they can't develop a plan for you because they don't understand you, they're indifferent to you.
Excellent. And I'm going to ask Sister Crystal to look at her poem and choose out an appropriate section to read it back again. And I'm going to ask the operator to search back for Hero. Because in light of what Brother Eric has said, we have got to show ourselves this image of ourselves as heroes, as unconquerable heroes, and to understand that there's
heroes.
An articulation of it.
We're the first engineers, doctors, lawyers, agriculturalists, scientists, builders. That's us. Everybody learned from us.
First people on the planet and the mothers and fathers of all the peoples on the planet Earth. I know I've left Sister Wazero, Esther Gittins, and Brother Royston out of the discussion. But I'm going to bring you into the discussion after we look at two films. After we look at two films, Our Heritage, Our Cloth. And we're going to see in this the wealth of Africa, the wealth of how we sit down and we imagine, now here, you know, we can put this thing upon our body and here we go, we look in the forest and we see a tree and we take it and we weave it and bring beautiful cloth out of it. We're going to see another aspect of our imagination, the image that is inside of us. When you look at the cloth, you can see the images that are inside of us. And so our cloth, and we're going to look and see how they use it in weddings.
I get plans for you.
I know you take it for granted.
I go there, pray for you.
Anytime that you need it.
I go fly fast for you.
Girl, I know they deceive you.
My body, my fault.
You
I go there for you.
Oh, yeah, you
make me glow.
Oh, I get the boyfriend. Where they misbehave. She get the boyfriend. Where no like to spend. She get the boyfriend. He too day taco. She get the boyfriend. Oh my angel. She has that. She see I'm a pair. I'm a pair for long, for long. Olale sope o she enter DM o ramo beta o bossin check bullet with me abo fe fe se sha o pepe dem olale pepe dem o pepe dem olale pepe dem o pepe dem olale pepe dem.
Hello everyone, my name is Aries and welcome to my YouTube channel, the Rookie Fashion Icon. So this is like my first video and I kind of just decided to make it something a little introductory because what I do personally, my brand is my name, Aries, and I work with leather and fabric to make like pieces, fashion pieces. But for now what I'm doing is just female footwear, that is slippers and sandals, and yeah, it's pretty much something like this. This is a basic Ankara flip flop for ladies. It's a size 38. So I decided to just choose 10 African fabrics and I'm going to just give like a very brief and quick history about it, and I'm just going to narrow it down to be as simple as possible so this video is not really long and it doesn't get tiring or boring.
Number 1, Adire. Adire is a resist-dyed cloth produced and worn by the Yoruba people of southwestern Nigeria in West Africa. The word Adire means tied and dyed. Originally, the Adire cloth was made with indigo dye, but with the introduction of synthetic dyes, more colors and tints were used, and the label Adire sort of expanded to include also the wax resist method, which is technically the use of wax to make detailed patterns on the fabric before dyeing them. Number 2, Sheweshuo fabric. This is popularly worn by the South Africans, but it originated in Europe. Its name is derived from the connection this fabric had from the King of Lesotho, King Mashosho I. He was given this fabric by the French missionaries in the 1840s, and after a while, the fabric sort of became a part of their cultural wear. Sheweshuo fabric is manufactured with an acid discharge and roller printing technique on pure cotton fabric. It is traditionally used for weddings and family functions. Originally, it was dyed indigo, but the fabric is now manufactured in a variety of colors and printing designs characterized by sophisticated geometric patterns. Number 3, Basotho blanket, which is also known as Shona Marena. This is another fabric that was influenced by the same King Mashosho I. In the 19th century, he was gifted this by a man only known as Mr. Howell. But these beautiful blankets gained popularity in the Soto region and are now unique to the Kingdom of Lesotho. In earlier times, animal hides with hair still on them were used to make this fabric, but after the king was given his new blanket, he replaced his animal blanket with the woolen one and his people assimilated. After then, cotton and wool were used in place of animal skin in making their blankets. At number 4, we have Ankara, also known as African wax print. Ankara was originally manufactured by the Dutch for the Indonesian textile market, but the prints gained significantly more interest in the West African countries because of the tribal-like patterns. The patterns are being printed on 100% cotton to create these gorgeous fabrics. They are worn at weddings to identify with friends of the bride and groom, at birthdays to identify family and friends of the celebrant, and even at funerals to celebrate the departed. But these days, we have seen Ankara print on other textures of fabrics apart from cotton, like silk, chiffon, and even spandex. These are used to create more modern pieces like sportswear, or even swimwear. Number 5, Ashoke. Ashoke is created by the Yoruba people of southwestern Nigeria. Ashoke is also a hand loom cloth woven with silk and cotton threads. Ashoke is usually used by the Yoruba people for making the women's wrapper known as Iro, the men's gown known as Agbada, and men's hat known as Fila. These lovely pieces are also worn for ceremonies. Number 6, Kente. Kente fabric originated from the Ashanti people of Ghana. In earlier times, to create this fabric, threads are dyed using shaved tree bark and ground seeds that are pounded together to make dyes. The dyed threads are woven to form bands, which are further joined to make larger pieces that are sewn into clothes. Kente was originally manufactured in yellow and green, but now we see this fabric in different colors and designs without losing the Kente pattern. Number 7, we have Danshiki print, also known as Angelina print. From West Africa, the signature Danshiki pattern is printed on 100% on waxed cotton ground. This fabric is exceptionally breathable and perfect for warm summer months. Number 8, we have Bogolan or mud cloth. From Mali, this fabric is made by a special technique of dyeing using fermented mud. But firstly, the fabric is made by the men who weave threads into narrow strips and then join these strips to form larger pieces about a meter wide before sending them to the dye pits for beautification. In Malian culture, the hunters wear these mud clothes for camouflage, while the women wear it after birth because it's believed to have healing and protective powers. At number 9, we have the bark cloth. The bark cloth is a versatile material that was once common in Asia, Africa, and the Pacific, but it has been manufactured in Uganda for centuries. The fabric is made from trees of the Moraceae family, including the paper mulberry, breadfruit, and natal fig tree. Bark cloth is made by beating wet strips of the fibrous inner of these trees into sheets, which are then finished into a variety of items. Today, what is known as the bark cloth fabrics are made of densely woven cotton fibers, which are soft, thick, and slightly textured to resemble the rough surface of the bark of a tree. Some recent cotton-based fabrics are also named bark cloth for their resemblance to these traditional fabrics. Number 10 is the baole fabric from Cote d'Ivoire. This textile is made by hand. The local craftsperson first converts raw cotton to single threads. Then these threads are bleached to remove the impurities, then left to dry out under the sun. After probably a couple of days, these bleached threads are dyed with either mineral or vegetable-based dyes. Then when it's dry, the threads are fed into a mill or loom according to the pattern the craftsperson wants. These woven strips are then sewn together to form the whole fabric to be sewn into clothes. For centuries, the fabric has been mostly adorned during community gatherings, special events, traditional proceedings, and festivities. So that's pretty much it for now. You can rep your country by commenting down below the name of your country and a textile you love. Don't forget to like and subscribe and hit the notification to see my videos when I post them. Love you guys so much.
Yes, and so the image. I mean, when you look at the cloth and you see the beauty in the cloth, then you must understand that that is coming from inside the people. It's the beauty that is inside the people taking and making cloth out of the beauty that is inside of them. And when anybody puts it on, whether you're Indian, you're white, or whosoever, it lifts your own beauty up. Sister Crystal, what is your take on what you just saw?
You know, because of our European link, we were left with wearing, you know, shirts and ties and so on. So we failed to realize the beauty that lies within our clothing. So looking at that, I'm like, yo, I need an African wedding with all those beautiful prints, you know. And I, for us Guyanese, we're more familiar with the dashikis. You see us wearing a lot of the dashikis and the Kente print from Ghana. Mm-hmm. I particularly love those. But you asked me to read something, a piece from my poem.
Yes.
But I wanted to read something after listening to Mr. Phillips' presentation.
Masses, you do anything you feel like doing.
Persistence overcomes resistance. So here's the fact. Africans are back and there's no turning back. Giving up is never an option. It is not over until we win. So unleash the hero that is within.
Okay. Brother Royston, I see you shaking your head in quiet approval. Let me see what's in your mind.
When Eric presented, I recall that there were two things that that occurred way back, and perhaps are still happening now, that are kind of pushing back on our efforts. And one is the plunder that these people have done in our space, our things, and the pillage, which perhaps continue until now, mm-hmm. right? That those are two elements that have really pushed us back in significant ways, and we have to strive all constantly forward to make sure we break through and make well in our strides. And making those strides, of course, would be some enormous leaps. And I think there are about three or four pillars that we need to use if you're to really trot forward. One is land, as was mentioned, or we can't overstate that. And you know, we have to make that a one of our platforms or pillars moving forward. The other is perhaps labor. We have a lot of labor resources available to us. We have to make full use of that. Capital is the other one. And the fourth, but perhaps most vital one, is enterprise. All of this can come together and really move us forward if we, in our own spaces, organize to have our own enterprises. To go and work with someone to gain experience might be one thing. But we have to create our own enterprises to build on the wealth that you have in the land and the labor and such like. And so that will be my forward trust for wanting us to really move ourselves out of this perceived bottom of the ladder situation. But in doing that, I want to make mention of something which I've observed some years now, and I think we shared in that observation, us both. And that is, in the observance of this abolition of slavery period, the 1st of August, I don't want to call it emancipation because we have not been emancipated. It's an observation for this abolition relaxed period. And I noted, we both noted, that on the 1st of August, when we were celebrating and rejoicing and doing all our various things, there are some sects in the Indian community that observe or have the observance for, I think it's Lord Rama, Ravan.
You know, it's Krishna's birthday.
Krishna's birthday.
That's what we were told.
There it is. We are in celebratory mode, rejoicing and so on. And these people are going to work on the same day, doing stuff that we know not of. And so we have to be very careful in the things we do. And of course, there's nothing we can do to deal with what they are doing. But we have to have the kind of resource and resolve to secure our space and our beings so that we can continue to do the kind of things that our parents did when they came here, and to come off the plantations after 200 years of getting 0 cents or dollars for their work, but still go and buy over 200 plantations across this country. That's ingenious. And we have that within us. We have to get back to those places, to go after that place, find it, and restart the process. That we must do.
But what I continue to research, Brother Eric, and what I found is that the Africans had an economy even when they were enslaved.
Yeah.
They used to plant rice even way back then. If they find a piece of land next door to the plantation, they plant the rice, they plant their grown provisions, and they would sell it back to the Europeans.
Right.
Etc. But we're not going to discuss that right now. Except to say that, you know, when I sit down here and I listen to all that we have said, and when I listen to the genius of my young sister, y'all know what I'm going to say. Man, it makes me proud to be black. I don't want to be nothing else but black. Because we're going to win. Sister Esther, was zero. No, you're going to say something just now?
Yes, I was
zero, Esther, yeah.
I wanted to join in the conversation from where Brother Royston made the point of the activities of some of our fellow Guyanese on the Forest of August. I commend them for recognizing that the Forest of August, not to say that Africans in Guyana are supposed to be celebrating emancipation. I commend them for recognizing that it is an important day in their community and holding fast to their rituals that relate to that day. I say we should take a page out of their books in relation to that, because emancipation, everybody drumming, and some people will only wear their African clothes on that day and then they fold it up and they put it up for the rest of the year, and that's all emancipation means to them. Some of them, even especially the youth, they don't even want to eat a piece of conch or a pone on that day in observance of the day. They prefer to have the same KFC that they have in every day. So for most people, emancipation is just about a drum and you look nice for the one day and that's as far as it goes. But there is nothing emancipated about that. We have to use the same pillars that Brother Royson pointed out, and not forgetting spirituality, which is what our brothers and sisters are acknowledging on that day. And most
just a minute, when you say spirituality, we talking about Obia, right?
That's a good
talking
word.
About Obia, we talking about voodoo, we talking all about right. everything in Rastafari culture, everything that makes us black. And we know we're not a people that, for example, His Majesty say, Ethiopia enjoy diverse cultures. We are a people that come together and practice our rituals as however we see and believe, because we have many cultures and many ways of worshiping, many ways of honoring our ancestors, and many ways of...
You're pulling me into a discussion. And I ain't going to back out of this discussion. So you're telling me that... is it that you're saying that we have been miseducated?
We have been miseducated.
About our culture and especially our spiritual practices?
Especially about our spiritual practices.
Because I was always wondering, how come the Christians drink blood?
You mean why?
If I kill a fowl, when I build me house, I work in Obia.
Well, when Africans worked Obia, nobody could put a shackle and a chain on their hand. And in fact, they had to make sure that they kill our spirituality. And added to the four pillars that Brother Royson pointed out, we must add spirituality and language. And we seem to be skirting around language, but it's something we must deal with, because language is part of our imagery.
And
you can't imagine your African self without your African language, which is even the drums would tell you that.
I want to bring in, and because I want to focus a little bit on this very issue of spirituality. Brother Eric, Brother Royston, Sister Crystal, I'm throwing the question out to you. Do you think, or how would you speak to the issue of African spirituality? I'm going to say this. Is African spirituality established Haiti that they're trying to crush, but they can't crush? It was Bookman who said to Toussaint them, look, I don't do me work, you're going to tackle them now. And they have won that rebellion and they've tried over and over, but they can't crush Haiti. It therefore means that something is inside of our African spirituality. They tried to crush Africa, but they can't crush Africa. Do you think it's time for us to go back to our thing?
Yes, yeah, so right here, right next door to us, Suriname, and we know the Surinamese and us African Guyanese are related directly. The Jokers still practice their culture. They went up into the mountains, they got a village, they dressed the same way they used to originally, and they worship their own way, they live, they maintain their original lifestyle. Even in Jamaica, we got the Maroons, who I admired when I once visited there. Still wearing the leaf clothes, the wooden and vine clogs, and so on. And so it's not that we've totally lost our culture, but some of our brothers and sisters retreated and into the mountains and were able to preserve. And we need to know more about their practices, especially the Jokers, because we know we are directly related.
Because, yes, Brother Eric.
Africa has 3,000 tribes and 2,000 languages. Kwedu Mutwa, who recently died, he was called the wisest man in the world, and he was about African spirituality. We've been on this earth for 3.2 million years, as shown by the skeleton of Lucy. We had to have spirituality to have gone on earth for such a long time. Then man created religion and confused us with religion versus our spirituality. Even Rumi, one of the greatest philosophers as far as I'm concerned, say, I looked in temples, churches, and mosques for God, but I found him within me. So when you look at our ancestors over that long period of time, when they worshiped nature, it was them understanding themselves and the spirituality. Now we have all sorts of different religions, which I call philosophies, because if you're born in China, you get one exposed to one. You're born in India, you get exposed to another one. You're born in Asia, you get exposed to another one. You get born in the West, you get exposed to another one. All claiming different things about God, but they're philosophies. And depending on where you're born, you become Christian, Muslim, etc. Now, it's your choice as to what you want to believe. But you know you have some instincts that really are part of your spirituality, that guide you. That it's like you're the hidden voice, the silent voice. And we in Guyana, and we who have been enslaved, we've been taught to learn about everybody else. The Haitian Revolution, part of it was because they believed in their spirituality. Mm-hmm. They believed in their ancestors. And we get confused also about ancestral blessings and ancestral, how we worship it. Sure. Because Jesus is an ancestor. So if you want to look at Christianity, it's also ancestral worshiping of Jesus.
True.
So it depends on how you look at this intellectually. But remember that this earth is, we've been on this earth for 3.5 million years. And these religions are about 3,000 years old.
But you know what is interesting? What is interesting? Islam and Christianity, they focus on Abraham. Father Abraham had many sons, and many sons had Father Abraham. I'm one of them, and so are you. So let's just give praise.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. That is ancestor. That is ancestral recognition.
Yeah.
And then when the children of Israel were leaving Egypt, they make sure they dig up Jacob's bones. They did not leave Jacob's bones in Egypt. They carried it. And that, again, is ancestral paying obeisance to the ancestors. And so I find it interesting that somehow or the other, both of these religions have got a thing about black people looking back to their ancestors when the foundation of their religious observances and their whole philosophy is ancestral, is looking back to the ancestors. And so, Brother Royston, I give you a minute, and then Sister Crystal, if you care to, and then we close off with a discussion from Sister Esther. We got to come back to Rastafari. What does Rastafari need? And especially within the context of this discussion that we're having on spirituality. Brother Royston,
right. Two bits. One is that even now as we plant our parents and our loved ones, when they would have fallen out of the race of existence, or when they said they die, they sometimes say to us, look, I won't go back to. We've been living here for 60 years, but I won't go back to. And so that too shows same kind of ancestral connectivity. They won't go back to where their father buried, where their grandmother buried, all that kind of thing. So they're going to left as you come to Georgetown to bury. It happened with me just recently. And so that is one point I want to establish. The other point is, you mentioned Abraham, but Isaac, when he went to look after Jethro's herd, when he was about to leave to go back home, every time he got his stock to take, he said, nah, this is my stock. He said, okay, fine. He went, he took a vine herb in the water, and his herd flock became a different color. I mean, that is what we call our spirituality. We can do stuff with stuff and cause things to happen. And so for me, though we want to skin our faces on it, in the very holy book that you pick up every day, have things that says that we have ability to do magical things.
Mandrakes. Yes. Was mandrakes, right? I think that was the name of the herb, mandrake.
Yeah.
Mandrakes.
Right.
And so, I mean, it's there before us. Yes. And we practice it every day, consciously or unconsciously, and we have results from it. If we had more time, I would have shared with you another scenario we had, but that's for a different time.
Yes.
Sister Crystal.
It is always very interesting when the topic of religion and spirituality comes up in this space. So, I mean, you could call it the universe, you could call it ancestors, you can call it supreme being. Yes. That is left up to you and how you interpret it. Yep. Everyone has their own way of doing things, and everyone has to work out their own salvation with fear and trembling. So that's left up to you. However you want to interpret the word of God, that's up to you. But I know I worship the creator, not the created. So you guys, I don't know.
That little thing that you got on your head is what?
This is my crown.
What's this called? A tiara? That's a tiara?
No. It's a crown.
What it's a crown.
Yes.
Okay, Queen Candace.
Yes, the unconquered queen.
Sister Esther, Rastafari and this particular concept of this discussion of spirituality. I know when Rasta say his Imperial Majesty Selassie is God, everybody say we're really wrong with them.
Well, it comes from the concept that black man king is black man creator. And we know further history where at the time when His Majesty or Haile Selassie became visible to the world was a time where black men everywhere they found themselves, even on the continent, facing the whip across their backs. They were under slavery. So Haile Selassie came to black men everywhere and they couldn't hide him. 72 nations acknowledged when he became emperor on the 2nd of November 1930. That is when he actually became visible to the entire world. Black man everywhere saw His Majesty as a beacon of hope. Well, they had solid proof now that not every black man was left to slavery, and they knew, well, look, he's royalty, look at the splendor and the grandeur around him. So that gave them a beacon of hope. And having been foretold by Marcus Messiah Garvey, who black man everywhere looked up to at the time, because Marcus Garvey, whether deliberately or incidentally, did prophesy about the crowning of a king, and people must look to the east. So when people took Marcus' words seriously, and when they saw Rastafari, everybody latched on to him. Fortunately for us, we had brothers like Bob Marley and so on that utilized the speeches and the word and the works of Haile Selassie to propel what they were doing, and they used their music to take the word worldwide. And so you find Rastafari spread as a hope to black man everywhere. And we see too, even we're talking about language and spirituality, Haile Selassie caused the Ethiopia Orthodox churches to be built everywhere, like where black man found themselves, to remind them of Africa and to teach them the Amharic language as long as they found the need. So the church is a beacon and reminder of Africa, Ethiopia, and the language was which, and up to today, you have to pay to learn other languages, but Amharic is taught free at the Orthodox churches. And so Haile Selassie, I mean, a lot of times, especially when we're planning here, people wonder, why are you looking to Ethiopia? But Ethiopia is the one that pointed Rastafari to Africa. I could say, from my quest to Rastafari and teachings of Haile Selassie, made me look at the rest of Africa and acknowledge that my foreparents here in Guyana came from Ghana and the Congo and so on. I see our technician.
Showing that our time is up. We can continue this discussion next week.
You want the music though.
Yes. But so we gotta close out now with this particular song, I Smile. I Smile.
say we have time?
You said we don't have time.
Okay.